So today we're going to talk about product layout design, specifically different types of product layouts and establishing the amount of time required for each task and grouping different tasks. So let's begin. So when we're designing product layouts, it requires a lot of consideration of a few things. So we want to understand the sequence of tasks that have to be performed by a workstation, how many workstations, what's the order of these workstations, and what are the speed considerations? This is where we talk about something called line balancing, which we'll get to in a little bit. So if we understand a step, so this is similar to a flow chart, right? It's what happens first, second, third. And so right now we're just assuming something that's happening in series. Now there's some steps that could be in parallel. We haven't looked at that yet. But so for example, step one, what are some tasks that are immediate and what are their predecessors? So we need to figure that out. Then we have to determine the output rate. Then we have to determine their cycle time. Then we're going to calculate the theoretical minimum number of stations required so that we can determine what we want for the output rate. Then we can assign tasks to different workstations and then balance the line. Then we can calculate our efficiencies when we're done. So we're going to go through this six-step process, step by step, in this recording. So step one, first of all, we need to identify what the tasks are, what their immediate predecessors are. So in this case, we have an example 10.4 that we're using. So we have different work elements, so which we've labeled A through I. This is making a pizza, essentially. So we start with rolling the dough, place the dough on the cardboard backing, sprinkle cheese, spread sauce, add pepperoni, sausage, mushrooms, shrink wrap pizza, pack in a box, yada yada. Okay, so once we know what those are, now we know what the order can be. So the first thing before we can do anything else is we have to roll the dough. So there's no other predecessor. It's the very first thing that we have to do. Then we also have some estimated durations. How long does it take? So here we've got 50 seconds. All these durations are in seconds, by the way. Place cardboard backing, 5 seconds. It has to come after that. So if you notice, B has A as a predecessor. It requires A for it to be done. And likewise, C requires B to be done. D requires C to be done. Now, E, F, and G don't require each other. They just require that D is done. So this is why you see a parallel structure that spreads across here for E, F, and G from D. However, H requires that all of E, F, and G be done, and then that has to be done before you can package up everything, pack it all in the box. So if we were just to add up the times for each of these tasks, this is assuming it's in series. So we call it the total series task time. This would be 165 seconds if we did everything one by one. Now, in lots of projects and lots of places, you can actually do some things in parallel or have teams doing things in parallel. So this is what I call the critical path, projected time. And so this is something that you can solve for. We oftentimes use Microsoft Project, Project Libra. There's also Ganter, which is another project management software tool that's really good at taking these durations and taking the predecessors, and it maps it out into a network diagram like this. And in this way, you can see how things can get structured and where you can put parallelism. And the critical path is the critical time where it assumes that these other things are happening in parallel. So for the critical path, because G is the largest time moving forward, G is the one that we will add in 15. We won't add E and F because they're in parallel and these times are smaller. So they, if they were truly happening in parallel, they would happen in less time than G. So they would actually happen concurrently. So that reduces time to down to 143. Now, we don't use that 143 in the rest of this example, but for large projects or projects where you truly have teams to do these different types of tasks, the critical path is a better way to get a little bit more efficiency out of your system. Okay, so now we determine our output rate. The output rate is the number of units to be produced over a specific period of time. So in the example we have, the owner, Vicky, needs to produce 60 pizzas an hour. She needs to figure out how she can do that. So the current max of what she has is how many seconds are available to her in an hour, and what's the total series task time she's working with now. Now, we calculated the total series task time of 165 seconds per pizza or per unit, but she has 3,600 seconds in 1 hour. So you take that and divide it by the 165. So right now, the way her current process is in series is that you've got 21.8 pizzas per hour, assuming you have one workstation, or just those tasks in the series. Now, that's not even close to 60 pizzas per hour. So how do we improve efficiency? Well, we can create more stations. So she will need to divide the work among a number of people to have simultaneous workstations, or have work being done simultaneously at workstations. And again, remember, the goal is to design a product layout that can produce the desired number of units, which in this case is 60 pieces per hour, with the least amount of work centers. You could put tons of work centers, but you don't want to have more work centers than necessary, so that we can peak our efficiency. Okay, so we got to determine our cycle time. So we have cycle time calculations. That's the amount of time each workstation is allowed to complete its task. So cycle time is essentially the available time, which is the total number of seconds per hour, divided by the desired output. So remember, we have 3,600 seconds, or 60 minutes per hour times 60 seconds, is divided by 60 units per hour. So this is what she wants, right? So we're trying to determine what does the cycle time have to be to produce those 60 pies per hour. That means that we have to have 1 minute per unit. We only have 60 seconds to produce a pizza, so we've got to get one a minute. Okay, so that gives us a range then. So we have our ranges is going to be anywhere between our minimum cycle time, which is what we call our bottleneck cycle time. Now, the bottleneck cycle time was determined by which task, individual task, takes the longest period of time. To revisit that, I'm going to go back real quick. If you notice, out of all these tasks, which one has the largest time? It's actually rolling the dough, which had 50 seconds, way bigger than the rest of these. So that's where this 50 seconds comes from. Our bottleneck is rolling that dough, right? So that's where it takes the most time. Our maximum cycle time is the sum that we had. So that's our, think of this as our lower bound boundary and our upper boundary. The 165 is the sum of all the tasks. So the fastest we could possibly do anything is purely based on this bottleneck. Unless we change that bottleneck and can roll dough faster than 50 seconds, which we haven't proposed yet, but that's exactly where we would look to do something like that, we're not going to make anything faster than that 50 seconds. So that becomes our maximum output that we could possibly get for the whole workstation. So it's our available time, again, divided by that minimum cycle time. So we at least have to take 50 seconds per unit, assuming we're not changing our rollout method. So that means the peak that we could get is 72 pizzas per hour. Now, fortunately for us, that is greater than the 60 pizzas per hour that Vicky's trying to get. So it's possible. We now know that it's possible to do so. Now, if this number was lower than our desired, we'd be in a pickle. Then that would mean that's not going to work quite that way. We'd either have to work on this bottleneck to figure out how we can get that time down, or add more stations. So now we're going to look at the theoretical minimum number of stations that we need to produce what we want. So we want to achieve near to 100% efficiency if we get every second used. So if we sum up the task times again, which we've already done, it's 165 seconds divided by the desired cycle time, how many seconds per station, Then we get 2.75. Now, we can't have 3/4 of a station. We have to have a whole station, so we have to round up. So that rounds up to 3 stations. So that means we're going to break up these task work into 3 stations. So let's look at what that would look like. So workstation 1, so again, here we have a list where we're breaking every task down. And our task A, which was rolling the dough, is always the longest at 50 seconds. We need to be at 60 seconds or less. So fortunately, it's under the 60 seconds, which gives us 10 seconds of idle time, which means that this person at this workstation can do more than just roll the dough because the next step only takes 5 seconds. Because of that, we can use those other 5 seconds for them to be doing task B, and then there's an idle time of 5 seconds. Now, the way you kind of calculate this is 60 is what we want per station, because to produce 60 pizzas an hour means we have 60 seconds for each station. So we have 60 minus 50 is equal to 10. That's what we get here. Take the 10 minus the 5. That gives us 5 of idle time. So that's how we define workstation 1. Now there's C takes more than 5 seconds, so we can't include C in there. So we start again. So we have C, D, E, F, and G. So we start again with 60 seconds. C takes 25. That leaves 35. 35 minus 15 is equal to 20. 20 minus 15 is equal to 5. Okay, so that's about all we can do with workstation 2. Workstation 3, E, F, H, I. Now notice we have G in here, even though it's out of order, that's something that we have them doing. In here, we start again with 60 minus 12 is 48, 48 minus 10 is 38, 38 minus 18 is 20, 20 minus 15 is 5. So we've broken up the workstations for different things in this order for cycle time. And so that helps us bounce the line. So we start with the first station, choose the longest eligible task, and so on. When we have no more additional tasks, now we go to the next piece. It's like, okay, so how do we do? Computing efficiency and balancing delay. Efficiency is the ratio of the total productive time divided by the total time, where n is the number of stations that we have. Now we've decided on 3, and c is the desired cycle time. So again, we're using that total task times divided by n times c times 100%. So we have 165 seconds divided by 3 stations times 60 seconds. We get 100%. So that's seconds per station. So that's why stations would cancel. So we're getting an efficiency relatively of 91.7% of what we can do. So our balance delay then is simply 100% minus this 91.7%, which means we roughly have about 8.3% where we're not quite at 100% efficiency. And that's fine because there's always going to be other things going on. Not everybody can always be working at that peak efficiency all the time. So sometimes you'll absorb those amounts pretty quickly. All right, so that's kind of an example of how we balance a line and create a product process. All right. We'll talk about more things later on the next time in class. Thank you.